Sara Lance, Laurel Lance, and Felicity Smoke. You have failed this series.
As some of you may be aware, I have a really strange tendency to tune into shows mid-season. I'd heard of Smallville, but I didn't start watching Smallville until the end of season 6, and the only reason I got into that show was because of the Justice League episode, which featured Clark, Green Arrow, Cyborg, Impulse, and Aquaman breaking into Luthor Corp to shut down Lex Luthor's metahuman project, 33.1. It's an episode that was used for several fan-made trailers. When I saw that, I was thinking, well damn, if Smallville is ballsy enough to do that, I wonder what else they have up their sleeve. And I'd been watching the last 4 seasons ever since, although Geekvolution's counting CryptoFreaks has been somewhat useful in playing catch-up, because by season 10, Kara Kent is a series regular, we've had a cameo from the Legion of Superheroes, Clark Kent has been working at the Daily Planet as a reporter while moonlighting as a vigilante, Lex Luthor is revealed to have a sister we didn't know about until now in Tess Mercer, Clark has gotten into his second and third fight with Zod, as Major Zod, and the Kandorians, Milton Fine, aka Brainiac, aka the Brain Interactive Construct, is now a member of the Legion, reprogrammed as Brainiac 5, and there's been a half-assed attempt at a Doomsday storyline, most of it centering around a bullshit love triangle too ridiculous for me to mention on this channel. I had heard about Heroes, but I didn't start watching until season 3 premiered on the sadly now disavowed G4 TV. It lasted for 5 seasons and was given a questionable spin-off in Heroes Reborn. I had seen the pilots for both Gotham, The Flash, Supergirl, and Black Lightning, but the only show I've kept up with from start to finish is Marvel's Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., and before anyone asks, no, I haven't seen any of the Marvel Netflix shows, primarily because, at the time of this recording, I don't have a Netflix account. I didn't start watching Gotham again until second season, and we're 4 seasons in, and Bruce Wayne, Jim Gordon, and Selina Kyle are already taking some really, really huge steps. I didn't start watching CW's The Flash until I saw a preview for the Harrison Wells episode, where it's revealed by virtue of what's called a speed mirage to Cisco Ramon that Dr. Harrison Wells, the man mentoring Barry Allen, and incidentally in this timeline, the man responsible for giving Barry Allen his super speed, is actually a speedster from the 25th century, Eobard Thawne, the Reverse Flash. That episode, by the way, is what got me to start watching The Flash more frequently, and I'd been tuned in ever since. Long story short, season 2 is hit and miss, and seasons 3 and 4 are both questionable. The best thing season 4 has going for it is Barry Allen's far superior Flash costume. And no disrespect to people who like the show, but something about Black Lightning strikes me as a classic example of misunderstanding the rule of show don't tell. There's a lot of back and forth in the pilot and throughout the series about whether or not it's a good idea for Jefferson Pierce to come out of retirement as Black Lightning. But at the end of the day, it feels empty and, I hate to say, kind of unnecessarily flippant. And while I like certain things about the Supergirl pilot, and while Melissa Benoist seems like a competent actor, regardless of what network it's on, my thoughts about the show itself are best summarized in a Jamie Foxx quote you may or may not be familiar with unless you've seen the movie Jarhead. I bring this detail to your attention so that you understand that I have a tolerance threshold for the amount of idiocy that creeps up in modern television. Which brings us to the subject of today, the show that started it all, Arrow. I heard about Arrow after the tail end of Smallville's run, but I didn't start watching Arrow until halfway through season 2, with the Deathstroke episode, roughly 2 years later. After years of hearing about how popular Arrow was, I've dived headfirst into the show with only one goal: to find out if the hype for Arrow is warranted. Arrow is a very strange conundrum for me to talk about, because there are equal parts things I like about the show, things that I resent about the show, and things that kind of make me tilt my head. Like Oliver Queen throughout, Arrow shares the double identity of being the most popular and the most polarizing show on the CW. Also, full disclosure, I very nearly considered scrapping this video when I realized that another video producer, Ross McIntyre, had already completed a similar 4-part video called The Downfall of Arrow. Though, interestingly, he inferred that you can't really talk about where Arrow went wrong without discussing what the first two seasons did right. Season 1 is by no means perfect, but it's generally considered to be the best of the show. Season 2 is considered a close second, building on top of that, and Season 5 is considered the third best, bookending itself, of course, with Season 1. Seasons 3, 4, and 6 have a lot in common, not the least of which being that they're severely hated. But I think the thing that separates them from the seasons that are good, or at the very least, the seasons that people like, is that they suffer from a lack of focus. But there are certain things that keep coming to mind that I feel need to be addressed, one subject in particular. As you may have guessed from the title, I am of course referring to the Black Canary. The Black Canary is kind of a half character on the show. And at the risk of being a broken record, my definitive take on Black Canary is somewhere between Justice League Unlimited and Young Justice Season 1. One of the biggest complaints thrown against Arrow is that it's a Batman show before it's a Green Arrow show, that Oliver Queen is too brooding and that he doesn't have a sense of humor. A lot of people who don't care for Man of Steel as a Superman film are still expecting Superman to smile and be cheerful and happy. You can have a protagonist of your story be brooding and still give that protagonist a sense of humor and some levity to him or her. At least, I'd like to believe that that's possible. But I would remind you that that version of Superman doesn't have a good enough reason to be cheerful and happy. Yet. And the same thing applies to Oliver Queen. Oliver spent 10 years of his life, mostly on his own, on a knife's edge, with people left and right trying to either use him or kill him, and he spent 5 of those 10 years training to become a living weapon for the sole purpose of righting the wrongs of a man who was an accomplice to a conspiracy that involved mass genocide, and then trying to honor his best friend's memory to become less of the killer that he was as the Hood, and more of something closer to a hero as the Arrow, and then as the Green Arrow. And as the years have gone by, that self-proclaimed mission has gotten harder. Oliver's lost his humanity, lost his best friend, lost his mother to a drugged-up super soldier, lost his one and only ally to the man responsible for his best friend's death, lost his identity as the Arrow and had to start from scratch, lost the love of his life to a sociopath, lost the mother of his only son, and has very nearly lost his own sister, 3 times I might add, and at the time of this video, lost his right to be a father. This is not a man who has any reason whatsoever to tell jokes. And yet, for some truly bizarre reason, everybody is still expecting Oliver to have the wisecracking left-wing political view having mostly patriotic personality that's normally associated with Green Arrow. And yes, that's apparently a thing in the comics, made apparent in Justice League Unlimited, when he tells Superman, "I'm an old lefty." Although, I have no idea if this version of Oliver Queen is a Democrat, a Republican, or an independent, much less what his political views are, since he has very little experience in politics, despite being the mayor for over a year. But this is the same guy who broke into a maximum security prison to rescue his best friend and former bodyguard, so I guess we can assume that Oliver is a liberal in the sense that he believes in due process, if that's even at the forefront of his mind, but it's difficult to tell since we see very little of it, and I promise, that's the first and last time you'll ever hear me mention politics on this channel. Another big complaint thrown against the show by Green Arrow fans is that Black Canary isn't who or where she's supposed to be. Because with all the development thrown into Oliver Queen, Quentin Lance, Roy Harper, Thea Queen, John Diggle, Slade Wilson, Tommy Merlin, etc., Black Canary is the show's biggest blind spot right now. There seem to be 3 types of women in the Arrowverse. The kind of women you want to spend a whole afternoon with, mysterious women you want to know more about, and the kind of women you want to see get a piano dropped on them. Ever since Smallville, I knew that the CW didn't care about or know what to do with the Green Arrow Black Canary relationship. This was made apparent in the final season of Smallville, when Oliver Queen, for really no good reason, decides to marry Chloe I Can't Keep a Man to Save My Life Sullivan, even though he has more chemistry with Tessa Mercer than he does with any other woman in Smallville's universe, much less that busted-ass excuse for Black Canary, except for maybe Lois. But damn if Arrow doesn't take the piss. So, the Oliver and Felicity relationship. It would be all too easy for me to point to Olicity, there's a reason I'm not very good with ship names, as the cause for Black Canary's shortcomings in the show. It's a problem for Black Canary fans, mostly because Oliver and Dinah are traditionally supposed to be a couple in the comics. Much has already been made about just how tone-deaf this relationship is, both in relation to the comics and in relation to the show's own internal logic. So while I don't want to beat a dead horse, I'm simply going to say this. If it didn't make any sense in Smallville, it's going to make even less sense here. Although I do think it's interesting that in Smallville, that version of Oliver Queen was in a bullshit love triangle between the stereotypical blonde and the man who would become Superman, whereas in season 3 of Arrow, Oliver is in a bullshit love triangle between the stereotypical blonde and a character played by an actor who used to play Superman. But just because that's a problem in Smallville doesn't make it any more or less of a problem in Arrow. And even if it did, that seems like one in a laundry list of problems. This brings me to something that I feel needs to be addressed. The head-scratcher page I read for Arrow on TVTropes.com postulated not only that Arrow was intended as a Black Canary origin story for Laurel, but was always intended as a Black Canary origin story for Laurel. Which, I mean, first of all, the show is called Arrow, not Canary, or Laurel. Second of all, that's not how origin stories work. And third, if Arrow was always intended as a Black Canary origin story for Laurel, then A, it's not a very good origin, and B, they've done a real clusterfuck of a job with it, considering that the first two seasons revolved around a list of people involved with the Undertaking, and a drugged-up Slade Wilson planning to lay siege to Starling City to get revenge on Oliver Queen for Shadow's death, both of which had 100% fuck all to do with Laurel, beyond her rebound boyfriend Tommy Merlin dying in the earthquake, and I guess the fact that her sister was also on Lian Yu with Oliver and Slade. Oh, did I forget to mention that? For reasons I'm still trying to sort out, the writers apparently decided to resurrect Laurel's sister, Sara Lance, by not only revealing that she wasn't dead, but putting her front and center in the Black Canary persona, as the Canary. Which kind of puts Laurel at the disadvantage of being a spin-off of her sister, who she already has a strained relationship with, on top of all the cheating. And I think it would take a lot of guts and a lot of moxie for Laurel, whose animosity towards Sara for sleeping with Oliver is the reason she's on a warpath with him every time he enters a room, to even entertain the notion of emulating her after she dies, much less to become a vigilante. But disregarding what happens with Laurel in season 4, let's assume for a brief second that TV Tropes was correct, and that the entire run of Arrow, this series about a man righting his father's wrongs to protect his city and his family, is in fact an origin story that sees Dinah Laurel Lance, to paraphrase Linkara, coming into her own as the Green Arrow's lover and partner in ass-kicking, the Black Canary. Well, first and foremost, Laurel would have to find out from the beginning that Oliver is the hooded vigilante, and would have to know about the list, and need a compelling reason to fight alongside him. The former of which kinda happens anyway, but not for the reasons you'd expect. That only happens because Slade Wilson is hopped up on Murakuru in season 2. There are three big problems with Laurel becoming the Black Canary when she does. The first, as you may have already guessed from watching the show, is that Laurel doesn't have the sort of training her sister got from the League of Assassins. The only reason she's wearing the costume is because she was rushed into it. It comes off like three seasons in, they suddenly remembered, oh, wait a minute, isn't Laurel supposed to be the Black Canary? So they decided they needed to hurry the fuck up and put her in costume. But because she's had no formal training, it comes off as forced. The most mean-spirited thing that happens is with her training. At the end of the season 3 premiere, The Calm, Sara Lance is murdered by an unknown assailant. Spoilers, she's later resurrected in season 4 and is made a series regular on DC's Legends of Tomorrow. If you're wondering why it took so long for me to bring up Legends of Tomorrow, there's your answer. We later find out through plot convenience that Malcolm Merlin brainwashed his own daughter, Thea, into killing her. Yeah. Thea is apparently Malcolm Merlin's daughter. Long story, not relevant to this one. And Laurel spends nearly the entire first half of the season being trained in self-defense by former boxer Ted Grant, with minimal success. And after only spending 3 weeks with Miss Al-Ghul, she's apparently only marginally better than where she was before. Marginally. I'll let you fill in the blanks as to how busted that logic is. My point is, if Laurel is going to become a costume vigilante, Laurel, who by the way is a district attorney, she needs a believable reason to do so, and the stakes need to be higher than Laurel wanting to avenge her sister for the 900th time, especially when she's so desperate to kill Malcolm.